Turkey is heading for presidential and parliamentary elections on the 14th of May that could decide the future course of the country. The world's eyes are on it. Ankara's become a major regional power broker with growing ambitions for the world stage, often walking a geopolitical tightrope. But it's also been dealing with a major economic crisis stirring passions at home, and a tragedy caused by what's been described as the worst earthquake in a century.
So in this video, we have this woman who's from the earthquake-hit region from Hatay. She has lost 13 of her relatives in the earthquakes. And she says that her and her relatives had to remove their bodies from under the rubbles themselves.
My colleague Dilay Yalçın was overwhelmed by the grief and anger on social media.
She says, shame on this government. I will not forgive them. Even the grave will not accept them. They will be held to account in the ballots.
Evet, kendim kanlarıyla üçüncü gün sabahı sahaya inildim. Yazıklar olsun.
A lot of people feel this way. It was a devastating time. On the other hand, I've also come across people saying on these vox pops that the earthquake hit 11 provinces at the same time. So the government had a hard time responding.
People in Turkey have been living with a punishing economic crisis for years. The recent waves of earthquakes only added to their hardship. The videos Dilay's been watching are part of a street phenomenon that's been challenging the established media order. In recent years, dozens of YouTube channels have sprung up, taking the pulse of the streets and asking passers-by what they think about Turkey's problems. Why are so many people choosing to speak out in these impromptu street debates? And what does that mean for the upcoming elections? That's today's Global Jigsaw. I'm Krassi Twigg, and this is the Global Jigsaw, an original podcast from BBC Monitoring, zooming in on political, security and social shifts around the world through the lens of its media. Our team listens to, watches and analyzes media narratives in 100 languages.
Радио Тегеран.
Right, we must go now to Moscow.
Мы не вторгались на территорию Украины.
Western countries are not the international community. That era has finished.
조중 두 당 두 나라 최고 영도자 동지들께서는
I mean, have you got any thoughts on that?
In this episode, you'll hear Dilay Yalçın and William Armstrong from BBC Monitoring, as well as Onur Erem from the BBC's Turkish service. Dilay has been following the street debate movement for a while now, from her home city of Istanbul.
So what happens is, one YouTuber goes out on the street and just turns to anyone who's willing to speak out. And one person starts speaking about the economy, the difficulties they're having. And somebody else just passing by as they're speaking overhears the conversation and starts giving his own opinion. And a little later, a debate starts. Another person chimes in. You have a crowd of people discussing this one subject. Sometimes they're fighting, sometimes they're arguing, sometimes laughing, and sometimes you have the crowd applauding one of the speakers.
Give me a sense of how popular these street discussions are.
Well, I have to say that they are huge. I mean, vox pops have always been popular in Turkey since the early days of smartphones, but they have become even more popular with the economic meltdown of the country and the currency crisis. So right now, for example, if you go to YouTube, you'll find dozens of YouTubers doing these kind of vox pops, and they've been watched by millions of people. And so what happens is these vox pops first appear on YouTube, and then when they get a lot of attention there, you see them on Twitter, on Facebook, and then in the end, 2 days later, you will see them on an independent TV channel.
Why do you think they're so popular, Dilay?
Well, Turkish people can't get enough of them because Turkey's media environment is almost under complete control of Erdogan and his party. And, well, people turn to these videos because they feel like these videos are actually conveying their feelings about the country, their problems, their concerns about the future.
As someone who comes from the Balkans, my native Bulgaria borders Turkey, let's say I'm familiar with this direct and animated style of discussion that these young people are tapping into. But it takes savviness and grit to turn it into a livelihood.
They seem to be people who are mainly frustrated with the lack of free speech in the country. I spoke to one of them, a very popular one, Hasan Köksoy. He's based in the southern province, Antalya.
I started this vox pop business because of a bet. I got together with a few friends and we started talking about politics. And we made a bet and decided I would go out to the street and ask people if the government was doing a good job. I saw very interesting things, things we haven't seen in the media for many years existed on the street. I knew I could not stay silent from that moment on.
Who are the people taking part in these street discussions?
People from all ages and backgrounds are taking part in these debates, from high school students to elderly people.
100 lira. Ben okulu yumurta 2 günde bitiyor. Bir yarım kilo peynir 2 günde bitiyor. Ben nasıl idare ediyorum?
In this video, for example, you see a woman having an angry exchange with a man. She's shouting at the mic, whose stomach is full? How am I supposed to make ends meet? The man points out that if two people in the household work, then they can make ends meet. It should be possible, but she's definitely having none of it. Lately, many of these videos have focused on the government's response to the earthquake. But of course, for a long time before that, the big thing on everyone's mind was the economy. And then there was one elderly woman who was saying that she can't afford food for her grandson. And something that repeatedly happens in these videos is a government supporter will say, "Show me your phone," to the person who's complaining about the country's economy. This is actually a way to challenge the critics of the government, suggesting that they're either lying about the country's economy or that they are facing economic difficulties, not because of the government's management, but because they're investing in expensive phones instead of living by their standards.
The Turkish government has a reputation for cracking down on critical voices, even though it denies this. So I was just wondering, these videos going viral and some of them attracting huge number of views, as you were saying, have there been any attempts to take them down?
Well, there have been attempts to take them down. Some YouTubers have faced arrest, imprisonment, and one person was actually attacked. There has also been attempts to silence the people who speak out on these videos as well. At least one video blogger I spoke to has been charged with insulting the president.
Insulting the president has been a crime in Turkey for a century that could land you in jail for more than 4 years. And the law has been enforced against thousands of people since Recep Tayyip Erdogan came to power. In 2021, the European Court of Human Rights found it was a breach of the right to freedom of expression and told Turkey to change it. But that's yet to happen. Meanwhile, pro-government media claim that those who make the videos are out of control and do not respect the rule of law, that they target religious values and are funded by the opposition. They also claim that some of the participants are actors and that the aim of the videos is just to get clicks.
The YouTubers that I spoke to were very determined to not stop doing these videos. I asked Hasan if he was afraid.
I'm not afraid, because if I stop doing this job, the voice of those people will not be heard. The unlawfulness will continue. The wall of fear has collapsed. People do not stay silent. They are not afraid. I don't know how people have come to this point, but they are not afraid.
And what about the participants who are clearly not afraid to speak up? What makes them so bold?
A lot of people on these videos say that they do expect intimidation, but they also say that they're not afraid because some of them say we don't have anything to lose anymore, because the economy is so bad, because we're so hopeless about our future, about our children's future, that there's actually nothing left for us to do but speak out.
Making or taking part in these videos is clearly not without risk, but the phenomenon is growing. So why are they so compelling? William Armstrong has been watching the country for 12 years. He's one of BBC Monitoring's Turkey experts based in Istanbul.
These videos are indeed very striking. They give the viewer a sense that they're getting a spontaneous, unfiltered view from the street. A lot of these videos lean heavily towards the opposition, but some of them do have a more pro-government slant. One thing that unites all of them, though, is this rather sensationalist tone. So they do tend to emphasize outrageous exchanges between members of the public, watching people at a street market getting into blazing rows about cucumbers, for example.
What does this phenomenon tell you about the country?
I think it possibly says a few things about the public's thirst for authentic voices. A lot of opposition focus has switched in recent years to social media because of the media landscape that is very heavily tilted towards the pro-government side. And some of these YouTube channels do seem to have struck a chord with these audiences, and they've racked up pretty incredible viewing figures. And I think this also ties in with the heavy social media and internet use. Turkey is still a very young country with an average age of just over 30. So there is this big, ready audience for this kind of material.
And we come to the point when we need to talk about the economy. Inflation hit 85% in October 2022, triggered by the crash of the Turkish lira the previous autumn. And people seem to be so upset, they're willing to let rip to massive audiences on social media, despite the potential dangers of speaking out.
Well, the cost of living in Turkey is rising alarmingly. We've got electricity and gas prices rising, food prices rising, and rents also going up very sharply. And that latter point has been exacerbated, actually, by the earthquakes. We've seen people moving away from the earthquake zones, and that is also creating demand. Here in Istanbul, my own rent actually went up by over three times what it was 12 months ago, just recently. If you go to the supermarket, the price of an item 1 week is higher than it was the previous week. There's really no ignoring these rises for the vast majority of the population.
And in this feverish climate, it seems one reason for the street debate movement is that people believe pro-government TV channels are not representing their views. More than 90% of Turkish media is controlled by the government, according to the international NGO Reporters Without Borders. Dilay's been following what the mainstream media has been saying.
What people usually hear in pro-government media these days is how the government is going to fix the economy. For a long time, pro-government media outlets have said that Turkey's economy was under an attack by foreign forces that didn't want this country to be a leader in its region, to be the leader of the Muslim world, etc. But inflation has become so high that now the government is trying to raise the minimum wage, raise pensions, bonuses. There's also a housing scheme that's going on right now. That's what's been more reported in pro-government media these days.
You are listening to The Global Jigsaw from BBC Monitoring. Remember Turkey's history. Its predecessor was once a superpower with a vast territorial reach, which lasted for hundreds of years. The Ottoman Empire came to an end only at the start of the last century. Could this be the inspiration for Turkey's ambition to have a bigger role on the world stage?
It's very interesting. The Turkish government has a very nationalistic and very Islamic tone. And you can see this in pro-government news channels too. For example, this very popular pro-government news channel, Ahabaj, has a morning bulletin that's also very popular. It's presented by Erkan Tan, and he starts every morning with prayers. He has on-set props like Ottoman soldiers, the Ottoman flag, the Turkish flag. They're always on his table. He's, you know, trying to appeal to people's nationalistic religious feelings. He very much represents what the government wants people to hear, that the whole world is going through a hard time economically and Erdogan is the reliable leader to weather the storm.
In other words, be patient. We'll fix the economy. What seems to be missing from that narrative is the real hardship so many people are experiencing right now. How did the country get here? I asked Onur Erem from BBC Turkish to give us a fact file on Turkey's recent history.
When the ruling AK Party, that stands for Justice and Development in Turkish, came to power in 2002, it was seen as a breath of fresh air. Its success in staying in power for two decades is largely attributed to its co-founder, President Recep Tayyip Erdogan. When he first became prime minister, he aspired to make Turkey an EU member and talked about improving rights. But there has been a major shift since then. One turning point was his response to nationwide anti-government Gezi Park protests of 2013. The military coup attempt in July 2016 was another watershed moment. Erdogan declared a state of emergency that lasted 2 years. Hundreds of thousands of people, mostly journalists, academics, and military officers, were arrested or dismissed from work over their alleged relations to the coup. In 2018, Turkey transitioned to a presidential system that granted sweeping powers to Erdogan. The government said the system would bring more prosperity, but the Turkish economy has worsened in recent years, and Erdogan has adopted an increasingly nationalist and religious narrative to appeal to his voters.
As Onur pointed out, many government critics continue to be arrested, and for many years, Turkey topped the list of countries with the highest number of journalists in jail. So perhaps it's not surprising that some of these young citizen journalists also say they have faced intimidation. William again.
Turkey is a pretty tough environment for journalists. Thousands of people have been investigated and arrested in recent years on charges of insulting President Erdogan. Turkey also recently introduced a controversial quote-unquote disinformation law, which could even see people found guilty of spreading disinformation sent to jail for up to 3 years. And we saw examples of this in the aftermath of the recent earthquakes. For example, Mir Ali Kocher, a freelance journalist in the earthquake zone, who reported very extensively on the damage and the aftermath of the earthquakes, and was quite critical of the official response. He had an investigation opened against him based on this quote-unquote disinformation law.
And yet, people are willing to speak out.
When one person speaks out, it does give some kind of bravery or courage to other people who see that happening. And I think we actually saw that in the aftermath of the recent earthquakes. We saw a huge outpouring of criticism against the authorities over the search and rescue efforts in the aftermath of the earthquake, and indeed over the lack of implementation of safety regulations in the years leading up to the earthquake, which many critics said led to the high death counts and the major damage that we saw across 11 different provinces. I think that sense of criticism does tap into this strong and lively tradition that Turkey does have of dissent and public debate, and indeed democracy going back decades. So despite the very real dangers that people face, a lot of people here are still pretty tenacious.
Turkey has a tradition of dissent and free thinking, as William was saying. Reining in independent old-style media is one thing, but taming social media, that's a completely different challenge.
Turkey has always had a quite lively media environment. It's only really in the last few years that it's come much more under the thumb of a single authority in the government. Obviously, social media has emerged as a forum in response to that, for people to speak out. But at the same time, that has also become an area of some government influence. I think the authorities are acutely aware of the fact that a lot of particularly young people's opinions are formed on there.
How are they trying to control the social media space?
Well, the government has in the past temporarily blocked access to Twitter, for example. It also imposed a block in the immediate aftermath of the earthquakes. And many critics saw that block on access as a pretty direct attempt to control the narrative. A piece of legislation recently imposed tight restrictions on international social media companies, obliging them to store user data in Turkey and appoint legal representatives in the country to comply with content removal requests. And failure to comply leads to fines, advertising bans, and severe bandwidth reductions that basically renders these platforms unusable.
But while the country's leader targets the online spaces with legislation, he's often been successful in setting the agenda on those same spaces by using other tools, speeches.
Multiple speeches sometimes by President Erdogan.
Yurt dışından ve ülkemiz içinden kimi siyasetçiler?
William would know. He watches them on a daily basis for a living.
And all the media outlets broadcast these live and then on loop afterwards. And it does dominate the agenda in many ways. When Erdogan comes out and says something outrageous, it also sets the social media agenda because people get very angry about it.
How does the government defend what's trying to do to control the media? And what's the narrative coming from them?
The government very often frames debates in the country, the political agenda, in a very black and white way. So the opposition or even independent media outlets are often labelled as fifth columns, essentially, who have dark interests associated with foreign powers seeking to bring down Erdogan, to bring down Turkey. And that really does justify the government in doing pretty much anything it wants. It's really the classic populist playbook.
Turkey's imminent elections are extremely important. They're seen by many as a choice between democracy and autocracy. But when times are so turbulent and stakes so high, making predictions is a risky business.
Turkish politics, Turkish news is a real roller coaster. The agenda changes 180 degrees almost by the day, by the week. And I think it's very hard to say at the moment exactly how all these things that we're talking about are going to play out in the vote. Historically, governments in Turkey have changed because of economic conditions. In fact, Erdogan's government itself swept to power back in 2002 after a major financial crisis. Erdogan remains a very formidable campaigner, a very strong communicator, a very charismatic figure for many people. And obviously, the government has control over much of the media and most state resources.
And there's something else that might appeal to voters. Turkey commanding attention on the global stage, particularly over its role as a mediator in the war in Ukraine. Moscow returning to the grain deal just days after it pulled out at the end of last year was widely seen as a sign of Turkey's growing persuasion power. Is the president's boosted international profile strong enough to weather the crises at home?
Erdogan has been very active since the start of Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Turkey still has very strong ties to both Kiev and Moscow, and Erdogan has tried to leverage that to boost Turkey's international profile as a mediator between both sides. And I think that's gone down pretty well at home. People like the idea of this leader on the world stage playing this constructive global role as it's presented. And I think also there's this sense that in this international turbulence that we're all experiencing, this severe economic shock that everyone's familiar with, and natural disasters like the recent earthquake, a strong, safe pair of hands is appealing for a lot of people. What happens in Turkey doesn't stay in Turkey, and any political shifts that occur here are going to have regional effects in the Middle East, but also in Europe, in the Black Sea region with regard to Russia's calculations. But that's why Turkey remains a pretty interesting country to keep in mind.
You might think of the street debate videos at a time of acute economic crisis, a war, and a natural disaster as a digital manifestation of the age-old bread price protest. In this country of tight media control, more and more people are refusing to be silenced, as we've been hearing from Dilay Yalçın, William Armstrong, and Onur Erem. This episode of The Global Jigsaw was produced by Anne Dixey and Krista Satori. Original music was composed by Pete Cunningham. The sound engineer is John Boland. If there's a story you'd like us to cover, please get in touch. Our email address is theglobaljigsaw, all one word, at bbc.co.uk. And if you missed it, do catch up with our last episode, which explores an unusual jihadist venture into civilian governance in northern Syria. And if you can, subscribe or follow The Global Jigsaw so you never miss an edition. But for now, I'm Krassi Twigg. Thanks for your company, and do join us again next time.